I'd like to stay here longer than man's allotted days, and watch the fleeting changes of life's uneven ways. But if my Savior calls me to that sweet home on high, I'll live with Him forever in glory by and by. Oh yes, I'll live in glory by and by. I'll tell and sing love's story, tell love's story there on high. There with my dear Redeemer, there no more to die. Oh yes, I'll live in glory, glory by and by. A service along this pilgrim way, and lead the lost to Jesus as fervently I pray. As day by day I travel, I'll keep Him ever nigh, and live with Him forever in glory by and by. Oh yes, I'll live in glory by and by. I'll tell and sing a story, tell of story there on high. There with my dear Redeemer, there no more to die. Oh yes, I'll live in glory, glory by and by. The end I know is nearing, by faith I look away to yonder home supernal, the land of endless day. I'll cling to Him forever and look beyond the sky and spend the endless ages in glory by and by. Oh, yes, I'll live in glory by and by. I'll tell and sing the story, tell of there on high. There with my dear Redeemer, there no more to die. Oh, yes, I'll live in glory, glory by and by. Sing to me of heaven, sing that song of peace. From the toils that bind me, it will bring release. Burdens will be lifted that are pressing so. Showers of great blessing o'er my heart will flow. Sing to me of heaven, let me fondly dream of its golden glory, of its pearly gleam. Sing to me when shadows of the evening fall. Sing to me of heaven, sweetest song of all. Sing to me of heaven as I walk alone, dreaming of the comrades that so long have gone. In a fairer region among the angel throng, they are happy as they sing that old sweet song. Sing to me of heaven, let me fondly dream of its golden glory, of its pearly gleam. Sing to me when shadows of the evening fall. Sing to me of heaven, sweetest song of all. Sing to me of heaven, tenderly and low, till the shadows o'er me rise and swiftly go. When my heart is weary, when the day is long, sing to me of heaven, sing that old sweet song. Sing to me of heaven, let me fondly dream of its golden glory, of its pearly gleam. Sing to me when shadows of the evening fall. Sing to me of heaven, sweetest song of all. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to to tell the story, thrill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, 'tis pleasant to repeat what seems each time I tell it more wonderfully sweet. I love to tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God's own holy word. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, for those who know it best seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of glory I sing the new song, 'twill be the old, old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love.
Good morning. Welcome to the Sunday morning worship of the League City Church of Christ, or League City family. God bless you. We love you. Thanks for being present, participating, and enjoying this time of worship together. God bless you. To our community, to the rest of the country even, and those of you who are tuning in to be a part of this, we want to be a blessing to you. Thank you for being a part of this. If there's something we might be able to do to encourage you, to help you in your walk with God at this time, we want to do that, whether it's staying connected here on our Facebook page, tuning in to our website, lccfc.org, or our office is open during the week still. We want to be a blessing to you and know how we might be able to serve you and help you. But again, at this time, just thanks for being a part of our worship and joining in at this time. Right now, just push pause on everything else that's going on. Even though it might be convenient, it's easy to get comfortable and take this as a lax thing. This is a serious opportunity for us to worship our God together, to spend time in honor and praising our Father. And we want you to take that serious, and we want you to participate with us in this blessed time, even though it's not how any of us would want to do it. But here we are. And so I would like us, like you to know that in a moment, we're going to be led in a word of prayer. We're going to also have an opportunity to commune together around the Lord's table. I'll share some thoughts at the appropriate time. We'll have some hymns mixed in there. And then, as always, Tyler is going to come and bring us a wonderful lesson from the Word of God. And so we're looking forward for you to be able to participate and be a part of that. As we enter into this moment together, would you pray with me? Our Father, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for the many mighty and wonderful things that you do for us. God, for being our God, for the access that we have now through Jesus to communicate with you, to lift our requests to you, just to talk to you and speak to you, that we can unveil our hearts to you. We ask, dear God, that you help us to have a special focus in these different environments to be able to worship you, to give you what you deserve. Father, we're so grateful for many who are adapting, taking on new roles, adjusting in ways that we never saw coming, and that you're walking with us through those times. We praise you for that. we ask, dear God, that as we do go through these different times, Father, as we fall short of who we need to be, we ask for your forgiveness. We ask for your blessings, God, and we ask for you most of all at this time just to be with us as we worship you, and we strive to do so in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name that we pray, amen.
In the grave he lay, Jesus my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus my Lord.
As we prepare to partake of the Lord's Supper together, if you have your Bibles, turn to Luke 22 and Luke 23, and we'll read some passages and invite you to let this focus your thoughts to think about Jesus and his sacrifice. I don't know about you, but I'm a sucker for these stories, success stories. And when you read these stories, one of the common threads is this passion people have. And then not only this passion, it's the sacrifices they're willing to make in order to see that passion come to fruition, even against all odds. And so as we thought about that, or as I thought about that, this quote came to mind. It says, when we forget ourselves, we usually do something that everyone else remembers. When we forget ourselves, we usually do something that everyone else remembers. And there's perhaps not something more important that we need to remember, or that we do remember as followers of Jesus and what he did when he forgot himself. In reading from Luke chapter 22, Jesus said in verse 18, "For I tell you that from now on I'll not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom comes." And he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, verse 20, the cup, after they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." The passion of Jesus, right, linked to that word suffering, what he was about to do and suffering and sacrificing on our behalf. We read and we know when Jesus is about to be betrayed, he's with his disciples in the garden. He's just told them to pray that they don't enter temptation. And then he withdraws himself and he makes the same prayer he told them to pray, essentially. When he withdrew, he knelt down and he prayed, saying, "Father, if you're willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." And there appeared to him an angel from heaven strengthening him. I think about that experience, the whole passion story, if you will, as you think about his suffering, his sacrifice, and what gave him that passion. What was his passion? as we think about our word passion, what lit his fire. In Luke 19 and verse 10, he said the reason that he came, right, was to seek and save the lost. And so ultimately, I can think about me as that passion. I was his passion, the willingness, he was willing to go to God and God would walk with him as the cup didn't pass, did it? He drank it and he went through all those things for me. And it's an unbelievable thought. I hope your mind will go here. Maybe read through Luke 23, Luke 22, as you think about the sacrifice of Jesus, as we commune together, as we partake now and have a prayer for this bread, may we remember the amazing thought that we were on his mind as he died and shed his blood for us. Let's pray. Our Father, we are in awe, even questioning, who are we that you're mindful of us, that you would do such a thing for us, and yet at the same time, we're in awe of the fact that you have, that we're so strengthened and encouraged by that thought, and yet our hearts also are burdened at this time as we think about our sin, as we think about our unworthiness. We ask that you help us to think about those things and give those to you. God, that we can just rest in your grace, we can rest in your mercy, and that we can understand, dear God, your plan. Your plan that took Jesus and the sacrifice that was made as we partake of this bread. We remember his body, his life that was given for us. We praise you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. This time, offer a prayer for the cup. We think about the blood of Jesus that washes away our sins, and remember this time together as we partake of this cup. Would you pray again with me? Our Father, we again lift our hearts to you with gratitude, with just thankfulness. God, we love you. We're mindful of your plan that called for Jesus to suffer. It was necessary, as you give us and tell us in your word, that Jesus suffer. And that thought that we were on his mind, we were on your mind throughout that whole process, we are in awe. We thank you. Thank you for this cup. We pray, dear God, that you help us to remove the things that are keeping us from you, that you help us to be reconnected, that we offer the forgiveness that we need to offer, God, that we reconnect to the people that we need to reconnect to, God, that we put away the things we need to put away, and that we put on, dear God, a passion for you and a love for you as we remember and we think about the blood of Jesus that was shed for our sins. We praise you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me ever to adore thee, may I still thy goodness prove, while the hope of endless glory fills my heart with joy and love. Here I raise my hand. pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Never let me wander from thee, never leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Well, I hope this finds you doing well on this Lord's Day morning. And we're going to start like we usually do with a word of prayer. But before I lead us in that prayer, I want to explain what we're doing with the lesson. We're continuing the lesson we started last week, and it was originally recorded as a single lesson. But as I was delivering it, I got carried away, as you know I do from time to time, and it ended up being much longer than I planned for it to be. And rather than re-record it, we decided to just divide it into two parts. So that's why the first part ended rather abruptly. We had a tight edit there where we just kind of stopped it at the end of that first point. And what we looked at already is Habakkuk's complaint to God. And actually, he makes two complaints to the Lord, and each time the Lord answers. His main complaint was he didn't understand how God, who is holy, could use a sinful nation to chastise Israel. But the Lord makes it clear that after he uses Babylon to punish Israel for her sins, the Lord would then bring judgment on Babylon. And so he reassures Habakkuk and tells him to trust me, that you shall live by faith. And so we titled the lesson by that statement, "The righteous shall live by faith." So now we're going to continue where Habakkuk makes a prayer, a plea to God, and we're leading up to this great, great text at the very end of this tremendous little prophetic book from the Old Testament. And I hope we can hear the voice of God speaking to us through this and encouraging us. So let's open our hearts to the Word of God and let's go to our Father in prayer as we begin. Let's pray. Holy Father, great God in heaven, all glory and honor and praise to your name. Through Christ our Savior, Father, we ask for your blessings on us as we study your word on this Lord's Day when our Savior rose from the dead. We're thankful for Jesus and his suffering for us, and to know that he lives and that he reigns at your right hand and makes intercession for us, and that he's coming again, Father. May we live with the expectation, with the earnest desire and the hope and the longing for his return when we can all be with you. We ask a blessing, Father, on our leaders as they deal with this crisis that we're going through, and for our leaders in your churches also, Father. Bless our elders here at League City, and bless the shepherds who are tending to your flocks around the country and around the world, and keep your people strong and faithful. Lord, I ask that you would help us to use this time to grow in our love for you, to meditate on your word, to seek you, Father, and to study and to be fruitful with what opportunities we have to minister one to another. Father, we pray that in this time you would keep us near to you and near to each other. Even though we can't be together, Father, bless us with a sense of your presence and with a renewed awareness of our fellowship and our bonds together, our bond in Christ, Father, that ties us together and makes us one in Him. And Father, we thank You for every good thing that we have. Please continue to supply our needs and bless those, especially among us who are out of work and maybe without a paycheck right now and who are facing uncertainty about their jobs. Lord, we pray the things we're talking about this morning in this lesson would help us to put our trust in You and truly to live by faith in You. For we know, Lord, that You are faithful. And so we rejoice in that. And Father, we ask You to receive our prayer, to bless each one as You see that we have need, Father. For in the name of our Lord Jesus, we offer You our praise and our thanks and ask all of these things. Amen. And so let's now return to our lesson. All right, let's move in. And these next points are much briefer, so don't panic here. Habakkuk's prayer. So we get to chapter 3 and Habakkuk's prayer. I want you to notice this is a powerful text here. And I want to, if you'll pause for a moment, I need to correct something here. All right, let's start this over. I practiced this earlier and then I forgot to reset it. So you already got a little taste of what's about to come. But as he replies with a prayer, notice in verse 1, this is a prayer that he utters here, and that Shigionoth is that word. May be a reference to that this is a psalm or some kind of instrument, something that's to be played. But notice he says, O Lord, I have heard the report of You and Your work. And O Lord, do I fear. In the midst of the years, revive it. In the midst of the year. See, it's like a song and there's a chorus and he's repeating it. In the midst of the years, make it known. So he's saying, oh, I'm accepting it, Lord. And You're the one working. And so do what You have done in the past and bring Your mighty hand to bear in the world and bring to pass what Your will is. But notice he says at the end, but he says, but as You do it, Lord, now I'm simply saying, bring it to pass. I'm accepting it. He's questioning it. He's questioning it earlier. Now he's saying, bring it to pass. But as You do, Lord, look at this, in wrath, remember mercy. Wow, what a great statement. In wrath, remember mercy. As You bring judgment on us and as Your wrath is poured out, please remember mercy. The reason that's powerful to me is because, well, let me ask you, what is it where we see the ultimate expression of both God's wrath and His mercy? Where do we see God's wrath and His mercy come together? It's in the cross. Think about this with me for a moment here. Paul in Romans chapter 5, this is Romans chapter 5. He talks about how God shows His love for us and that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Then look at verse 9. Since therefore we've now been justified by His blood, much more shall we be saved. What? Saved by Him from the wrath of God. Notice that. From the wrath of God. So here he's talking about the wrath of God. Christ saves us through His suffering. He bore God's wrath for you and for me that we deserve. So there's the wrath of God. He's saving us from His wrath. And in Ephesians 2, now this text is Ephesians 2. Notice it says, God being rich in mercy because of His great love with He loved us. And then he goes on to say, by grace you've been saved. And He raised us up with Him, seated us in the heavenly places in Christ. So that, look at verse 7, in the coming ages He might show the immeasurable riches of His grace and His kindness. Look at this, the mercy, the love, the grace, the kindness that He's shown toward us in Christ. Verse 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith. Now there's the faith part again. And this is not of your own doing, it's the gift of God, not the result of works, lest any man should boast. So notice, we see Christ saving us from the wrath of God. And in so doing, he's manifesting the mercy of God. And so the cross is the place where the wrath and the mercy of God meet, as he pours out the wrath that I deserve because of my sin, so that he can show mercy to me and extend forgiveness to me, so that I don't have to bear that punishment. So he can be a just God and still show mercy. Paul says that in Romans 3, 23 through 26. It's one of the most important texts in all the Bible, how the cross shows that God can be a just God who administers wrath for sin and yet still justify us or consider us just or forgiven in Christ. That's where the wrath and mercy of God meet, in the cross. I just think that's a great statement that we don't want to pass by, because it does make us, our minds, or it should, I think, go to the cross. But now finally, we just got a couple of minutes before we're done here. Let's look at Habakkuk's joy. Habakkuk's joy here, because now we come to the end. Now this is dramatic. I want you to look at what's happening here. In chapter 3, you can go back and read it later. He then begins to recount how God, he uses this great, lofty, apocalyptic language, how God, he's thinking back in history, how God has moved in a great way, worked in this world to administer his judgment and his punishment so that he could preserve and save the people of Israel. And so he thinks about how God has worked in the world in the past as he's punished others, as he's moved on behalf of Israel, on behalf of his anointed, he says. And so as he's thinking about how powerful and how mighty God is, and now he's thinking how that mighty hand of God is about to come upon Israel. All right? It's very important to get the impact of this final text to realize what Habakkuk is talking about here. And as he thinks about that, look what he says. Look what he says in verse 16. I hear and my body trembles. My lips quiver at the sound. Rottenness enters my bones. My legs tremble beneath me. Have you ever received news that was so alarming that you were trembling when you heard it? You were shaking? Have you ever heard anything that made your legs weak? My legs tremble beneath me, that made you buckle at the knees, or maybe even collapse. I hope you've never had to hear anything that serious or that dramatic. But that's what's happening to him as he thinks about God's judgment coming. But even in the midst of that, notice he says, yet I will quietly wait for the day of trouble. Quietly. You remember that? Let all the earth keep silence. It's the idea of acceptance, of recognition. Yet I will quietly wait for the day of trouble to come upon us and those who invade us. Then we get to his expression of faith in these final, beautiful, and powerful words. Look at this as you get to the end of the text. Verse 17, though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God the Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread on my high places. All right, just a word about this. Though the fig tree shouldn't blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail. This is talking about when you're invaded by another country, there's economic collapse. The olive industry, that was very important to Israel's economy. So if he says the produce of the olive fail, this is a staple of Israel's economy, of their lives. And so that means, and he says the fields yield no food. That means when you go to the marketplace, there's not going to be any food there. That's what I was thinking about when I said earlier, I thought of this passage. When you go to the store right now, you try to buy bottled water, it's all gone. For some mysterious reason, all the toilet paper disappeared right away and people were hoarding it. You look at certain shelves, like where the canned goods are, they're all gone. I mean, thankfully the Pop-Tarts are still there. At least as I've gone to the store, I've noticed. But I'm trying not to hoard them. I'm trying to leave a few for other people. But, you know, what if things got worse and worse and worse, God forbid, and you went to the store and all the shelves were empty. And, you know, you've got children to feed maybe. And you're wondering, well, what's going to happen? Is there more food coming? Look, Habakkuk says, even if the shelves are all empty, even if this comes and it brings this kind of hardship on us, he said, yet, despite all of that, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. Notice, because I know God will ultimately bring me salvation. That's what he's working in my life ultimately, is we know the salvation of our souls. But he's saying, I'm still going to have joy in the Lord. I'm going to take joy in him. In other words, I'm not going to let these circumstances that I'm struggling through, I'm not going to let that rob me of my joy. That's what I wanted to get across to all of us in this lesson this morning. I want us to remember that no matter what's happening in the world and no matter what we're struggling through in our personal lives, it does not have to rob us of our joy in the Lord, because we know he's the God of our salvation. Notice he says God, verse 19, God, the Lord is my strength. And right there, he's actually saying Yahweh or Yahweh Adonai. That is the covenant name of God. And then Adonai, my Lord, God, the Lord, Adon for Lord, God, Yahweh, the Lord, he is my strength. I'm putting my trust in him. He makes my feet like the deer's. In other words, I'm not going to stumble. He's actually going to make me be able to be on the high places. Like when you look up and you see the deer able to be up high on the mountain. And that's how the Lord is going to hold me and strengthen me and take care of me. And I'm not going to lose joy in the Lord. I want you to take time reflecting on that. And I would encourage you to commit these few short verses to memory here. That even though the fig tree doesn't blossom, even though the flock be cut off from the fold, all of that, that you can still take joy in the Lord. Now, as we close, I want to extend an important invitation to all of you watching out there, because there may be some, you may be sharing this with others, and some may watch it later, maybe watching now, who have not obeyed the gospel of Christ, and you're not Christians. Well, notice, in the New Testament, Paul cites that statement from Habakkuk when he says in Romans chapter 1, 16 and 17, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation. Through the good news of Christ, that's God's power to save us. And he says it's the power of God to salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, for in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written. And then he cites, notice he says, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. That's that statement from Habakkuk. So he's showing you that's the way you receive salvation, through faith, through trusting what God has done in Christ. And the response of that faith is, we find in Acts 2, verses 36 through 38, when Peter preached that message of salvation in Christ, that God has shown his righteousness in Christ and how he makes us righteous in Christ. When he announced Jesus as Christ and Lord, and people were cut to the heart and asked what to do to be saved, and he told them, repent. I thought I had this on a slide, but I just noticed that I did not have it. I apologize. But in Acts 2:38, he tells them what their faith should lead them to do. This is how you come into possession of the righteousness that comes by those to those who live by faith. He told them in Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So that faith needs to lead to a change in your life. That's repentance, where you're going to turn away from sin and turn to God. And then in baptism, when you're immersed in water, Romans 6:3-6 says you rise to walk in a new life. And there you receive the forgiveness of your sins by the blood of Jesus Christ. And so other passages will show us how we receive that blessing by faith. But I want us to remember as I close here, and I thought, I apologize, but yes, I do have it. I want to finish with a question here. Will you act on what the Bible says in order to be saved by faith? And we just explain how that faith moves you to receive His salvation. If we can help you, contact us, and we would be glad to help you. But brother or sister in the Lord, will you live by faith? Notice that passage says, the just shall live. They shall live by faith. And that's quoted in Hebrews 11:38, when it talks about having faith that endures, that perseveres to the saving of the soul. That's the kind of faith that we need in these troubling times, and that we need at all times. Will you live by faith? That's the question that is before us from Habakkuk this morning. Is the Lord your joy? Do you rejoice in Him? Is the Lord God your strength this morning? If we can help Him to be that for you and to be what He's calling on you to be, let us know. And let's finish once more. I know the lesson was long, but let's finish with a word of prayer. Dear Lord God, we know You are working even in these present circumstances, in these troubling times, to bring about Your ultimate purpose. May we put our trust in You, Father. We pray that nothing would take away the joy that we have in You. May that joy be our strength, Father. You, our Lord and our God, You are our strength in Jesus Christ. And may we hold forth the message of the gospel so that others can know how to be saved by faith, Lord, and that we would show others how that we are living by faith, that we put our trust in You. And because of that, Lord, that is why we have joy. That is why nothing can take that joy away from us, Lord. We pray that we might have that, and that we might be able to be instruments in Your hand so that others will have it as well. May Your grace be on each one, Father. Keep us by Your grace and power. As we're apart from one another, Lord, hold us near to Your heart, we pray. And we ask for Your blessings and for Your mercy, for Your will to be done. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, Holy Father, we ask all these things. Amen. Thank you for being with us this morning, and God bless you and keep you.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord lift His countenance upon you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you,
and be gracious unto you,
and be gracious. The Lord be gracious, gracious unto you.
called heaven. It's made for the pure and the free. These truths in God's word he has given. How beautiful heaven must be. How beautiful heaven must be. Sweet home of the happy and free. Fair haven of rest for the weary. How beautiful heaven must be. In heaven no drooping nor pining, no wishing for elsewhere to be. God's light is forever there shining. How beautiful heaven must be. How beautiful heaven must be. Must be. Sweet home of the happy and free. Fair haven of rest for the weary. How beautiful heaven must be. The angels so sweetly are singing up there by the beautiful sea. The song of redemption is ringing. How beautiful heaven must be. How beautiful heaven must be. Sweet home of the happy and free. Fair haven of rest for the weary. How beautiful heaven must be. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe displayed. And sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent into time, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. is doing so much for me. With what joy I tell the story of the love that makes men free. Till my earthly life is ended,
I will say
Psalms above
and beside the crystal sea.
More and more my soul shall be praising Jesus and his love.
He is everything to me,
He is everything to me, and everything shall always be. I will never cease to raise a song of gladness in His praise, and in the world above, my soul shall sing of saving love, life and light, and joy is He, the precious friend who died for me.
Glory be to Him forever, endless praises to Christ the Lamb. He has filled my life with sunshine, He has made me what I am. Oh, that everyone would know Him.
Trust the love
of the mighty friend above and be His forevermore.
He is everything to me,
He is everything to me, and everything shall always be. I will never cease to raise a song of gladness in His praise, and in the world above, my soul shall sing of saving love, life and light, and joy is He,
the precious friend who died for me.